I'm going to start on this merry question. How close are we right now as we look at Russian interference into NATO airspace with jets and drones? How close are we at this point to conflict with Russia?
Thanks, Tom. When we did our first funding round, I remember in 2021, when defense wasn't that popular, to be honest, amongst investors, and no European VC wanted to touch us, we had a slide in our pitch deck that said that we thought there was going to be a galvanizing event, and that was going to be an invasion of Ukraine by Russia, which I guess we got right, but what we got wrong was the timing, because we thought it was going to happen in 2025. And as we all know, in the event, it happened at the beginning of 2022. And ever since then, we believe it's rational to be cautious and optimistic, pessimistic, because the reality is that it's too hard to predict right now. And how close are we right now to another conflict, maybe at the NATO eastern flank? The date that we're hearing everywhere is that we all have to be ready and operational by 2029 at the latest. So when we think about systems that we're developing, you know, either in prototype form or going into mass production, we always have that day, 2029, in mind.
2029. NATO countries have now committed to 5% of spending, 5% of GDP. How is that? That's going to take some time to trickle through, but it's starting. How is that changing defense innovation, both here in the UK and on the continent?
So first of all, it's good to see those increases, and they're now real increases. It's particularly visible right now in Germany, but also a number of the Scandinavian countries. The reason it matters is not just because of the pure increase in money. I think that matters as well. There is a very specific reason it matters for innovation and for what we call defense technology, and the new technology that's now required in defense, which is based on autonomous systems and on AI and software. And the reason is that existing defense budgets tend to be entirely locked up already in legacy programs. So even if, as a country, you wanted to reallocate that money, you actually find it politically really difficult, because it usually means canceling projects and programs that a lot of jobs relying on. So it doesn't tend to happen. The thing that now is happening, again, with Germany probably being the best example of the additional funding becoming available, is that you can start new programs and new ambitious programs without cutting old ones. And this is why I'm worried about countries that don't significantly increase the defense spend right now, because what it makes it very hard in that particular case is to actually, you know, introduce new technologies, because it's so hard to cut legacy programs.
And so that links to a question around procurement, which can be a years-long process. Is that still a roadblock? How much of that funding is going to come through to defense tech like Helsing and other startups versus the legacy primes?
It is happening now. Again, in reality, we're seeing a lot of tanks still being bought and artillery systems being bought. And I think that's okay up to a point. And that point is where it can't cut too much into defense spend, the new defense spend. So what we're seeing right now, again, in the countries I mentioned earlier, is that there is now a real commitment to A, spend money on new systems, new autonomous systems, what we call autonomous mass, but B, also do so in a much faster way than previously. So, you know, 18 months ago, I would have complained a lot about the speed of procurement. It is actually getting a lot faster now.
There's a lot of focus on supply chains right now. This conference is focused on sovereignty as well, and we're thinking about rare earths, and just today, or in less 24 hours, the US and Australia inking a deal around minerals and rare earths. How vulnerable are you at Helsing and others within the defense space to a dependence on rare earths from China? How do we make more resilient supply chains here? How much of a gap is there?
Yeah, I think we all share a certain vulnerability, obviously, across different countries and across industry. Defense isn't the only industry that's dependent. It is true that rare earths are a problem, but I think the problems actually start elsewhere. There's a whole number of components that you can source in limited numbers from all kinds of different suppliers and countries. What we've learned, especially now that we're going to mass production for some of our systems, it's one thing to build dozens or hundreds of something. It's another thing to build 10,000s or hundreds of thousands. And that kind of scalable supply chain, particularly when you make it, if you want to make it resilient, is still a challenge.
It feels like there are hundreds of drone companies being started up here in Europe. I mean, obviously, almost on kind of on daily basis. And I think according to some reports, there are over 100 different drone startups. So as we think about the capital that's going into defense tech, Is that rational? Are we seeing a bubble in when it comes to drone startups here? How are we thinking about whether or not that fund flow specifically into drone makers is rational?
I think there's definitely a bubble right now. And the reason for it is what I said earlier. In 2021, not a single European VC in particular wanted to touch defense. Now everyone has moved into defense, and including the crypto caravan that's moved from crypto now into defense and is trying to spend its money there. I think in some ways it doesn't matter. It creates noise in the market, obviously, but there is a lot of money, I think, that's not going to see a return. Hmm. And the reason is that I think people use their muscle memory and their experience in VC, which is all around founder quality, which is, of course, important, but also product market fit, which is important, but is only a small part of being successful in defense. If you want to build a prime in defense, you need to understand procurement. You need to have government relations teams. You need to be able to think about even security clearance, understand export law, et cetera. And these are all subject matters that are quite different from product market fit. So if you just go for drones, drone manufacturers that look that they have a good program or a good product that might be useful, you're probably not going to see a return because there are too many of them right now. And there won't be that many programs of records for large drone purchases either.
So there's going to be consolidation when it comes to the drone startups. Is that what you foresee? And you're going to be active in that space?
So there'll be some consolidation. I think there'll be a lot of drone startups and, in fact, defense startups that are going to disappear again over time. We have a Cambrian explosion at the moment, which is fine. I think it's to be expected. But probably 80% of those companies aren't going to make it.
80% are not going to make it. Talking of your acquisition strategy, if you can just outline that for us, because you recently made an acquisition in Australia for underwater drones. So you've got the air drones underwater, and then you've got your systems around fighter jets, which we'll get onto, autonomous fighter jets. What is the acquisition strategy at Helsing? You're looking at full stack. You've gone from software through hardware. What does Helsing look like in 5 years in terms of the bits that are missing now and what you hope to?
Yeah, I mean, Helsing's focus is software and AI. That's how we started the company. That's been initially our pure focus. What we've now done over time is layer in hardware expertise where we required it. A good example is the HX2. It's our strike drone where we needed to be able to design something where we could absorb a lot of the complexity of the hardware into software and then start thinking about designing this for mass manufacturing. That didn't exist in the market, and whenever that's the case, it doesn't exist, then we build hardware ourselves. If we find that hardware exists, even in prototype form, that may be useful for us, we either partner with companies or in some cases we acquire them as well. Blue Ocean is an example of a company that we acquired. We've been developing together with them an underwater glider called SG-1 Fathom, mm-hmm. which can stay underwater for several weeks and uses what we call a large acoustic model, so a big neural network to scan the underwater acoustic signals for nefarious objects.
I touched on air warfare there because you've done some test flights recently with your Centaur system in terms of unmanned, or at least there was a pilot, but the controls are taken over by your software system with the Saab Gripen E. How much progress has been made? When do we start seeing that operational?
Yeah, so Centaur is a system. It's a reinforcement learning-based agent, a little bit similar to what you will have seen in AlphaGo and AlphaStar with DeepMind, that we've trained through self-play against each other to essentially become as good as a human fighter pilot in what's called BVR, Beyond Visual Range Air Combat. And that system achieved human performance last year, and it's since surpassed it. And it's one of those areas where we're incredibly proud that the team around Antoine Board, which we call Area 9, has been able to build a system in record time and actually show that in Europe we can build extremely advanced AI systems that can compete worldwide and that actually have implications for how we should think about crewed air combat, which we think over time is going to become more and more dangerous because you'll have drones coming up against you, but also large programs that are currently being set off, like, for example, FCAS, which is still a crewed aircraft program, where probably over time that is not the kind of system that you want to have.
Well, it's interesting you touch on FCAS. So this is this program being developed between France and Germany for a new fighter jet, but they're at loggerheads, essentially, and there's corporate reasons for that, maybe some political reasons for that as well. What's happening there? If Germany and France can't get together and build a fighter jet in this moment, what does that tell us?
I think there's still a political will to work together, obviously, and Europe needs to work together to build these systems, and we actually have a rich heritage of being able to build systems together. The Eurofighter Typhoon is one example, the Tornado is another, and there are many others as well. In the particular case of FCAS, obviously, the companies involved at the moment are not able to see eye to eye. That's also happened previously and needed a political intervention. At the moment, that hasn't happened yet. So at the moment, it looks like the...
What is your vision of what air warfare looks like in 5-10 years' time?
I think it's pretty clear that it's going to be largely uncrewed. And the reason is that the AI just makes faster decisions. It's able to find new strategies in ways that humans can't. And I think in a number of years' time, it will be ethically problematic to send humans into the sky against these...
And you touched on ethics there, because we're talking about unmanned systems piloted by AI agents. How deeply do you think about ethics, about the challenges of human in the loop, about who gets hold of your software systems and your hardware?
Yeah, we think that as a company that's steeped in democratic societies, we have a specific responsibility to think about the ethical side. You mentioned human in the loop. Our view is that the human should always be in the loop for systems. And once you have autonomous mass where you have so many systems that you can't monitor each one of them individually, you should at least have a human on the loop. And then you have to make sure that that human is actually an effective human in the loop or on the loop. So they need to be able to not be overwhelmed by the data, not be bored. And there are all kinds of KPIs that we need to track in terms of whether a human actually does their job that are currently being established. So this is one thing. The other thing that I think we have a special responsibility for is to think about who we make those technologies available to. What about proliferation, making sure that those systems are actually safe? And the way we approach it is that we have workshops that include our entire team. The company is now about 900 people, and many hundreds of them actually take part in these workshops regularly to discuss these topics, to come up with guidelines, and then to make recommendations to the management of the company. Because in particular in Europe, you need to have this broad church of people of all kinds of political backgrounds that can contribute to this kind of ethical muscle, as we call it, and build that ethical muscle so that we as companies can make the right decisions.
Are there countries, China you're not selling to, obviously, Russia you're not selling to. Are there European countries that you wouldn't sell to?
No, the way we look at this is that there are clear no's. North Korea is another one out of the list that you mentioned. And then there are clear yes as well. And then there are some countries that are kind of in the middle where there are edge cases. And for those, we actually, again, call together workshops. We have an ethics council as well that will make recommendations. And then we decide on a case-by-case basis, because quite often it depends on the circumstances and also the capability you make available.
Okay. I want to loop back to the supply chain question, because you're in operation in Ukraine. Has Helsing faced direct attempts by Russia at sabotage across any of your supply chains, any of your units and operations?
Yeah, one of our component suppliers was bombed, several weeks into deployment. And that was obviously horrible and a tragedy for them. It also meant that our supply chain was disrupted. We had to find that particular component again on the market. And this is a regular occurrence. It's obviously specifically problematic in Ukraine.
Okay, that's a regular occurrence. And when we think about the Russia risk, we think about the CEO of Rheinmetall as well and his own personal safety. Are you still working with Rheinmetall? What is your relationship with the prime? Do you see them as competitors or partners?
We see them as potential partners and friends. I'm not sure whether the feeling is always mutual. We work very closely with Saab, and we also have partnerships across the whole ecosystem. But the reality is that I think some of the primes right now see us as a threat. I think initially we were seen as a maybe sometimes convenient kind of add-on to what their capabilities. Now I think they see us more as a threat, but I think that over time will change as well, because there is a role for the primes, obviously. And if you look at Rheinmetall is doing an amazing job, creating and providing many of the systems that are required across Europe. BAE is another company. And I think what we're going to see over the next few years is that we're going to coexist and we're going to partner again as well. But at the moment, everyone is trying to figure out how we all relate to each other.
And before we wrap up, you spend a lot of time here in the UK and you cooperate with the Department of Defense. The UK obviously has a very close security relationship with the US. When we think about sovereignty, is that potentially a vulnerability for the UK?
I think we still need a close relationship with the US. I think that's pretty clear. What we can do and what we should do across all of Europe, by the way, not just the UK, is to build our own systems and be able to stand on our 2 feet so that we reduce some of the dependency, obviously, but that also we can meaningfully contribute to the security of Europe. And it's pretty clear that we haven't been able to do so over the past few years. It's changing now very rapidly. And my prediction, by the way, is that in the next few years, Europe is actually going to lead even over the US in terms of the deployment of real AI-enabled autonomous systems.
Europe is going to lead the US in the deployment.
I think so.
AI
I think
systems.
It's going to look that way in terms of the visibility we have right now in terms of deployment that's planned in terms of the volume of these autonomous systems, particularly for the NATO Eastern Flank, I think Europe is going to lead.
Okay.